interpreted, and lots to show you in terms of a little bit more of the physics and particularly a lot of the calculations. So I threw a bunch of more stuff out here, and actually some of the stuff we already did. Was hoping to get a little bit further. Here's my goal here today is to, again, just over and over again, show you Faraday's law. That little statement there, and of course put in mathematical form and calculate, is what this chapter is all about. And so, as I've joked in the past and many times and said, okay, you want all the answers for all the homework problems here for this chapter? Here's what it is. It is Faraday's law here. And so let me put it back in a nutshell here as I review what we did yesterday before we, or 2 days ago, before we jump into today. This is Faraday's law, okay? And I want to emphasize here, we've kind of shifted gears a little bit. We're still dealing with magnetism, but we're dealing with electromagnetism. We are now have crossed this bridge that we've done electricity separate, we've done magnetism separate. And the more interesting part here, near the end here, right when we get to the real good stuff, we're going to leave and you're going to have to do the rest of the good stuff later on in your educational career. But as the two interact with each other. And so I want to emphasize, before this semester is done, hopefully you will leave, you know, and if somebody asks you at Christmas time or even Thanksgiving, so what did you do in your science class? You could say, I learned there are two ways to make an electric field. So let's review that. The first way. What's the first way to make an electric field? Yeah, just those individual charges, chunks of charges added up, the kind of stuff we've been doing since the very beginning of this class. Fair enough. But the second way is what I'm trying to introduce now. What's the second way of making an electric field? A changing magnetic field. There it is in Faraday's law. Simply put, that the magnitude of the EMF induced in a circuit, which means it's related to an electric field, so that's where we got to continue our discussion today, but the magnitude of that EMF is equal to the rate of change of the magnetic flux. And so notice it is more complicated than just magnetic field, it's magnetic flux through the circuit. Simply put, in equation form, what does that look like? Well, E for EMF is equal to capital phi sub B for flux. Rate of change is the derivative of the flux with respect to time. Okay? And that's really what that is saying. I'm not going to put a box around it quite yet because we want to build this a little bit bigger here, and that's what we'll do in the next few moments. But I showed you at least this much. What I showed you last time was, let's take something such as this loop right here and then make a change in flux. And so this has a coil, and you can probably see it's got a lot of turns. What you probably can't see is it says that there are 3,400 turns of wire in here. But as I've hooked it up, this red one here goes into the plus side. This black one here goes to the negative side. But if I were to bring any magnet near it, such as this strong one, well, I don't want my hand to block it. How about this one? If I bring this near, what do you notice as I am bringing it? This ammeter then indicates some kind of current. And so there is a current. In other words, this is acting as a battery, if you will. This is acting as an EMF. Where does it get it? The change in the flux. And that's what we were trying to say. So I showed you a bunch of examples. I'll show you more today and do a lot of calculations here. But that's the goal of this chapter, to show you that there is a second way of making an electric field, a second way of making an EMF. And it's not just with the individual charges, but it's the changing magnetic flux. Notice again that when the magnet sits in here, there is flux in the circuit. Does that produce an EMF? No. What do you need to produce an EMF? A change. And that word is very important and easy to overlook. It does not just say the magnetic flux, it says the change in that magnetic flux. And I must admit, probably the most common mistake made here in this chapter by the students, at least I've seen in the whatever 18 years back, however long I've been teaching this thing, and it's they miss this word. They miss change. in Faraday's law. They also miss the word change in Lenz's law as we continue on. So pay close attention. It's not the amount of flux, it's the amount of change of flux. And it's more than that. It's the rate at which the change takes place. Because right now I don't get any EMF because there's no change. If I were to pull it out, would I get a change? Sure. But what if I pull it out slowly? Can you see I'm getting a little current? What if I pull it out quickly? Push it in quickly. Pull it out slowly. Okay. So again, want to emphasize here, it is not the flux, it is the change in flux. It is more than the change of flux. It is the rate of the change in flux. That's the key to it. And so hopefully throughout the day, you will see that. That it's not the flux, the change of flux. It's not just the change, it's the rate of the change of flux. And that's the one we should. And the flux could change in many ways. The simplest case is for me to bring a magnet closer and further. That's one way. But any combination, and unfortunately, there's not be even possible for me to show you all the different combinations that could occur. You just need to remember that you're going to have homework problems and ones that, you know, like, hey, I've never seen something quite like that, but look at the flux. For example, I could move the coil towards the magnet, right? I could rotate the coil near the magnet. I think one of the more interesting ones was the ones I showed you near the end of class, where I put a coil in here and then turned the current on. Turned it off. And notice there is an EMF, but only when you're turning it on or off. Because again, what produces the EMF? The change. All right. So anything involving a change. Change in angle, change in strength, change in current that is making the magnetic field. Change in area itself. I can't really demonstrate that, but I could have this coil and if I could squish it or stretch it, right? That would change the flux. So anything you can possibly imagine that would change the flux would then create an EMF. And that's what you saw last time. So let me continue on here. What if I did something such as the following? Now to see this, I probably need to get a very strong magnet. But I'm going to start with one wire that unfortunately is a little twisted here. But I've got one wire, and you can see it's a pretty long wire. So I'll get this strong magnet, and I claim that there would be an EMF in this circuit if I change the flux. Well, I guess I could change the flux by putting the wire through the magnet. So there is no flux. There is flux. There. Can you see a change at all? Can you see it just barely move? Now, this is a much stronger magnet than this. And yet I see very little current. How come? Could be resistance, but it's not. What if I did this? Yeah, it's that 3,400 turns that was in that one. See, what do you think might happen if I doubled it over? Can you see it more now? And so be a little careful here. That's why I didn't want to put a box around that quite yet, because there is an EMF for each loop. So if I take and double it up or triple it up, what do you think will happen now? And so I will have three times the EMF. What if I quadruple four times? See it more now? Five times. See it more now? Six, seven, eight, 3,400. So of course, to demonstrate it the first time, I did a bunch of turns. So let me add to this little equation. This equation probably should have an N in front of it to make it more complete. N being, like before, the number of loops here. So in other words, we can do the change in flux in one loop and then just multiply it by how many loops you have. And so that's why I, like I said, I use the 3400 one and then here to demonstrate that. And we'll throw one more in here. What direction is the EMF? And this negative sign is going to give me the direction. Now, the truth is I probably won't calculate it too much with a negative sign because we will just write out in words Lenz's law. And I think there's an easier way to get the direction than simply putting a negative sign and paying attention to the flux. And that's why the second one, I will guess right out here, gives us the direction. And so this negative sign is really Lenz's law. Here's what Lenz states in words, that the polarity, that is, what direction will the current flow? So the polarity of the induced EMF is such that it produces a current that will, let's see, got messed up here. A current that will create a magnetic flux to oppose the change in magnetic flux that is going or being forced through the loop. And there's a lot of words there, and it takes some time to read carefully with this, but the first thing I want to point out here is there's two magnetic fluxes here. Watch. Let me go back to the setup I had just a moment ago. I'll put the strong magnet over here for later on. I'll save the long wire also for later on here. But let's go back, and again, I want to show you. I'm going to put the black wire in the negative side of the ammeter and the red one in the positive side. So what that means then is when current goes in the positive, the needle will go positive. But when current goes the other direction, when current goes in the negative, the needle goes down. And so you saw that when I would take something like this bar magnet. And so there's a north pole and a south pole. I'll start with a north pole. And you saw when I were to put it in like this, you saw the needle go negative. When I pulled it out, you saw the needle go positive. But let's look closely at this statement. Because before the day's over and before you start working on the homework this weekend, we want to put these two pieces together. We want to say that this is the magnitude of the EMF and this is the direction of the EMF. And so let me focus a little bit here on the direction. I showed you last time a lot of cases of the fact that we are creating an EMF, and I'll show you even more today. More importantly, I'll do calculations. But this one, this can get tough. What is this saying? Well, let's take a look here. Take a look at this coil. And maybe I'll tilt it this way so you can see the windings a little bit. They're hard to see, so we've tied a string along here to indicate the directions of them. And if you look here, there is the string tied right here where the positive one is. And this string wraps around this way. All right? And so it's important we know what direction the string is tied here, or really what direction the wires are. The wires go around in this direction here. Okay? And so let me look above here. Okay? As I look above here and I take a magnet that says north, going back two chapters, we can see that the field from the north comes out like this. Right? And again, it's too bad we can't see these filled with our eyes. But imagine this thing sticking out from the north. That's what this picture is. If you look at this one on the right side or left side here, there is my North Pole. Right? And so what would happen then if I were to take this and put it in here? Well, let's see. While I'm putting it in, I guess I would say over here there would be no flux in here for getting the Earth's magnetic flux, okay? Because I'm only interested in change anyway. So there may be plenty of Earth's magnetic field, but it's not changing. All right. So I've got, let's just say, no flux in here. But as I bring this over, doesn't the flux from this one start to go down that direction? So what does Lenz's law say? The polarity of the EMF is such that the current that it will create, the magnetic flux created from that current, will oppose the magnetic flux from this one. You see in the two magnetic fluxes? There's a magnetic flux from this one in my hand. Let me point the north towards you. But once the current starts flowing, there's going to be a magnetic flux from the current flowing. So again, remember, there's no flux coming in or out of this little loop right here. And so as I go like this, I am now starting to put flux into the coil. So this should create a current, either this way or this way, but it should create it so that the flux opposes the change. So if I take my right hand and go back a chapter, when the current goes this way, doesn't that make flux up? So I'm trying to put flux in. Lenz's law is saying it will create some current to go back and oppose it. And so that should be the direction of the current. And if you look closely, the direction of that wire would then come to the plus, and that needle should go positive. So if I put this in, according to Lenz's law, it should make a positive direction on my ammeter. Well, definitely mass. I suppose so. I mean, certainly in terms of words, there is certainly an opposing. So maybe fair enough. I'm just a little cautious about taking the analogy too far. But okay, I'll say yes for now. So that alone, I'd say the analogy works well. But like all analogies, they probably break down at some point. Okay. But again, look very carefully at this. Maybe I was going to go to the picture, but maybe I'll just pull it out now. What direction will the needle go when I pull it out? Negative. Why? Yeah. Because right now, I would say I have some flux going in, don't I? And so when I go to pull it out, there's going to be less flux. What does Lenz's law say? It says we want to create current in that coil. Current in such a direction that the flux created by that current will oppose the change in flux from the magnet I'm taking out. So again, the magnet I have in there has flux going down. If I start taking it out, it's going to say, hey, wait, it's going away. What do I want to do? Well, I want to create flux to keep it down. And so I'm going to point my thumb down to keep the flux down. And if I look at my fingers, that means the current in the coil would go this way. And as I look at my wires here, as the current goes this way, it goes out this side and out the negative. And so when I pull it out, it goes negative. If I turn the magnet around, south pole, and I thrust the south pole into here, what's going to happen? Well, let's look at the flux again. I would say there's no flux in here right now. And as I go to thrust this in, this being a south pole means the flux is pointing up. So I'm going to go from no flux to flux pointing up. The current here wants to oppose that, so it means it wants flux down. So I'll put my thumb down, which means the current needs to go this way, which, according to these wires, means it's going to go in the negative. And so sure enough, a south pushed in makes it go down. Again, did you notice? Change in the flux. It's not the direction of the flux. It's the change in the flux. It opposes the change. If I take it out, what's going to happen here? Well, I would say right now, with the south pole going down, I have flux pointing up. And so flux is pointing up. And if I go to take it out, I won't have it pointing up anymore. So the current is going to oppose that change. It's going to make some up, because you're taking away my up. And so if I put my thumb up, my fingers will curl in this direction. And it'll go through here, which is the positive side. And so pulling it out will go positive. And so I want to say it again, and maybe jump over to this picture. Keep in mind that you determine the direction by focusing on the change in the flux. Not the flux. The change in the flux. And I think you see this really well in this picture here. In these two right here on the left, we each have a north pole. And the north pole is pointing into the little cylinder, or a coil there. But in this first one, you are thrusting it in. And so in this picture, it says, look, you already have the magnet partway in, and now you're pushing it more in. That means you're going from a little bit of flux in to a lot of flux in. And so they put a little delta B to indicate that is the direction of the flux. You are putting more flux into it. So the oppose is out. And so the induced magnetic field, which they put as a B, is out. Okay? And again, what makes this chapter challenging is you've got to focus on the change. And you need to remember that there are two different fields. There is the field from this one that is inducing a current which makes a field in this one. And we got to keep those straight. And that's why I like this picture, because the author has color-coded it with the one from the magnet in blue. And then broke it down not into just the B. We're not even focusing on the B. We're focusing on the delta B. You get that? And that's what I want you to focus your attention on, the change in the flux. And so as we thrust this magnet in, there's my delta B. So we're going to induce one that way. And to get a field that way, I have to take my right hand, point my thumb in the direction of the induced field, and in that coil then, the current would flow this way. And so this would be the positive side of the resistor, this would be the negative side of the resistor, and the current would flow from left to right in that one. Whereas the one below it, we are now pulling the magnet out. And so we already have the magnet close by, so we already have a B field, but as we pull it out, the change is that way, so the induced field is that way. So my right hand pointing my thumb that way would make the current flow that way, and then the current would go from plus to minus. It would go from right to left and be just the opposite. Does that make any sense? Yeah? And so getting these directions takes some time. And so here is the whole chapter. What is the strength of the EMF? What is the direction of the EMF? Let's try the south pole. I showed you this one too. Here's the south pole. So the south pole starts here where it's kind of already near it. And then they say, okay, what if you take this and you pull it out? So again, in blue, they show that you already have a magnetic field going out. But again, I want to emphasize, we're not worried about the field itself. We are interested in the change in the field, okay? So as they pull it out here, what they are saying here is the change is that way. We are going from a strong field that way to lesser of a field that way. So that means the change is that way. So the induced field in red is this way. And to get an induced field that way, you would have to have a current, thumb pointing that way, to the right, curled this way, meaning we'd go from plus to minus. Fair enough? And of course, the last possibility is the south pole being thrusted in. And so again, right here, you already have a field pointing that way from the south pole that's nearby. And as you thrust it in, you get more of a south pole in there. So the change in the field is that way, which means the induced field is going to be that way. To get a field that way, the current has to curl around in this direction, which would make it go from plus to minus. Right? And so that is what this chapter is about. All right, so maybe we should start with something that I think is the easiest one to do mathematically and do both at the same time. It's this picture here. We call this a motion EMF. This is a good example that involves all this stuff I've just been doing for the last few minutes, Lenz's law. But it also opens up the door to do a calculation. Doing a calculation with something like that would be pretty complicated here. So let's work on this picture. Oh, and that reminds me. I was going to pass out two things, and I think I only passed out one. Did a homework packet go out? Ah. One of these. This is really for me. I want you to first notice there's no place to put your name on it. You don't have to put your name on it. But I pick a class each semester and I decided I was going to grab this one. So I want to give you guys one of these forms. It's a little Scantron, really for feedback for me. How the heck am I doing here? So it has got a standard 18 questions that our school put together. And what I like even more, though, is the backside. The backside has an open-ended question. So this will really help me and learn what am I doing right and what am I doing wrong. All right. So grab one, take it, and sometime before the semester's over, fill it out and give it back to me. And that way, when I read them over the Christmas break, I can go, okay, that seemed to work fine. I will keep doing that. That doesn't seem to be working fine. I better change that. So there's some feedback for me. All right, so like I said, grab one and whenever you get done lab or leave it on my desk or slide it under my door or fill it out before we leave. We got an hour and a half here, but that's not a good idea. I don't want to lose your attention, so fill it out a little later. All right, now let's try this problem here. Because here is, like I said, probably the simplest case I can start off with this problem is here is a metal bar. This metal bar has got two rails, and we saw a situation kind of like this before. Two rails. This happens to have a resistor on it. The X's mean the magnetic field is going into the board. And so somebody comes along, that's why it says applied force, grabs it with their hand, and pulls on it. So that's, all right, let's pull on it. This crazy thing. Come on up. It's kind of blocking you guys' view, isn't it? I can, hopefully it won't be too hard to readjust that in a second there. But if I were to pull on that, I'll start off with just conceptually. I claim that there will be a current through that resistor. Why? Mm-hmm. Isn't there a change in flux in the rectangle that's made up of that loop? I mean, look closely at that loop. That loop has a resistor here, a metal bar here, a metal bar here, another metal bar there. And as you are pulling it out, aren't you just opening up the area? And so what did Faraday's law say that I erased it? It says an EMF will be produced if there is a change in the magnetic flux. And there is a change in the magnetic flux. Not because the field is getting stronger, not because I'm moving the wire or the magnet, but I'm increasing the area. And anything that changes the flux will make an EMF. And so which way will the current flow? Will it flow from the top of the resistor down or from the bottom up? Well, there's the answer. What way does it flow? Well, let's see. As that bar is moving out, isn't that giving me more flux in here? So I would say there's an increase of flux into the board. All right, so to oppose that, I would want flux out of the board. taking my right hand, putting my thumb out of the board, means the current would go around the loop in a counterclockwise direction. So the current should be flowing from here down to there. And so there's my EMF. There is, again, that second way of creating a current. I could have created a current by putting a battery here. So maybe I'll draw it here on the board here, but what I'm really saying here is that picture that you're looking at is the same as that. Right? There is a EMF. And the direction of that EMF is such that the current will go that way. Because current going that way means it makes flux out. And I want flux out because as I open up that metal bar, it goes in. And and obviously if the bar was moving the other way, the opposite would be true, but I should have pointed out. This then is the direction the bar is moving, velocity. And so there's Lenz's law. There's the answer to what direction is the current. Now let's answer the question of how much current is there. Hang on with that question. Let's just calculate the current, and then we'll expand on moving the bar. Because it is going to be difficult to move the bar. Well, I guess the answer is yes. And let's calculate how difficult it is to move the bar here. But let's just start with the current. Could you give me the EMF here? Well, let's give it a try. The equation we have is right here. It says the EMF is equal to the number of turns, I suppose it has a negative sign in front, times the time derivative of the flux. So it's already got the direction. Can I go ahead and just get rid of the negative sign? And so that's what I would encourage you. I'm not even going to worry about the negative sign. Negative sign is great. Then we get too much into details of clockwise, counterclockwise. Just do the Lenz's law. It opposes the flux. And so we already know from Lenz's law that the current is going from the top of the resistor down through. Okay, fair enough. Now, let's start putting in our numbers. I'll start here with N. What was N? Okay, it's the number of loops, and in this case, it's real simple, just one little loop there. Okay, so I will put the number N, or number 1 there for N. Okay, then I've got the derivative. How do we calculate flux again? The integral of B dot dA, fair enough? Okay. For this case, what is the angle between B and dA? Well, B is into the screen, right? Where's dA? It's perpendicular to the surface, right? Okay, so this is the little rectangle I'm talking about, right? What is the flux in that rectangle? And the area vector is perpendicular to that surface. So it's out of the board or into the board, but either way, it's either 0 or 180. That's either a 1 or a negative 1, whichever way you want to look at it. But again, I'm just doing absolute value. So I'm going to say here that I've got a B times a dA times a cosine of, and you can put 0 degrees or you can put 180 degrees and we can debate on the difference. Not necessary, because I am going to just say this is the absolute value of it. Okay? All right, next step. Derivative with respect to time of an integral over space. Now again, reason I picked this one is it's probably the easiest one to do first. It's not completely clear since I just pulled the picture up, but if you've got a chance to read the chapter, it'll say on this very first problem that the field is uniform. And the author kind of illustrates that. See how the green X's are equally spaced? So what can I do with the magnetic field? If the magnetic field is a constant, what can I do with it? Pull it in front of the integral? Can I pull it in front of the derivative? All right. I can pull it in front of the integral. And I can't pull it in front of the derivative. But this is the easy case. Could it be possible that it be a constant over the area but changing with time. Which means what? I can pull it out of the integral, but not pull it in front of the derivative. You catch that? This is going to matter soon. Not for this problem. But we've got calculus here. We've got two pieces. We've got one, which is an integral over space. So we need to ask ourselves, is it a constant in space? And the second question is it a constant in time? And this one, there you're just saying it's a constant field, meaning it's a constant space and constant time. But it is possible, and will soon happen, that what we could have is this field could have been made by a giant solenoid out here. And what we know with the solenoid is that the magnetic field is uniform in space, but depends on the current in the solenoid. And the current in the solenoid could change with time. You catching that? Are you really catching that? Even though this is a short chapter, it always comes back to the magnetic field from the solenoid and the toroid and all the stuff we just did. So we need to be careful here. But, as I said, for this first case, the magnetic field is a constant in both space and time. And so, I have an integral of just the area. Well, that's kind of nice, because then, when I integrate the dA, don't I just get the area of this rectangle? And what is the area of this rectangle? Using their symbols, it's x this way and l that way, right? So I'd say it's l times x. So there's l times x. Question?
So if we move the bar, and that in turn created an opposing magnetic flux, wouldn't that affect the source of the original magnetic field and create a current through it?
Oh, yeah.
Its magnetic field?
You bet.
So it would be impossible for that to be constant.
Yeah. So this is a first order approximation. We'll do that next year. Yeah. Yeah. And this is what really can make electromagnetics a very challenging and difficult subject, and one that, you know, it seems like you never get the exact answer. It is, okay, how much you want to approximate it, because if this one affects that one, then that makes a current, which now this one affects back on that one, which then changes the current, which was changing that one, which then fades, which that, and that's what differential equations is all about. How does the rate of change of this one affect the rate of change of that one? So we have coupled differential equations and coupled problems. And they're not always so easy to solve. Sometimes the only thing you do is you set up a Riemann sum and you put it into a computer and calculate the number and say, okay, I'll take the first term, the first two, the first three, the first million, the first billion. You know, I just don't want to do more than a billion calculations. So that's what you're left with. Yep. Yep. Okay. So the feedback from the electromagnetics is very involved. Yep. But in the simplest case, we'll ignore the feedback. And just say, look, as this thing moves, even though it may affect this other thing maybe is a big, strong, permanent magnet, has very little effect, we'll ignore that, at which case I can pull the B field out. Now I've got another question here. Now that I got a time derivative, anything in here that changes with time? Yeah, and in this scenario, the L is the same, but the X is changing, right? And in fact, what would you call this dx dt? Velocity. And so there is our first calculation. Our simplest calculation that we can do is called a motion EMF. It is simply nothing more than a metal bar sliding across a wire here. It will create an EMF. This is a good example of Faraday's law, and you get this. You get the EMF is equal to BLV. So there's the voltage in our circuit. So this little voltage is B, L, and V. And if I go this one step further and ask, okay, how much current would be created in this little circuit, I would have Ohm's law. And then putting what I just did of Faraday's law together with Ohm's law, I would say B times L times V divided by R. That's how much current I'm going to get. It gets better still. So we created some current. Some current's flowing in here. But if current is flowing in here, don't we have current in a magnetic field? And what happens when we have current in a magnetic field? There's a force on it. And so if I put my right hand with my fingers going in the direction of the current, and I close it towards the magnetic field, there should be a magnetic force. And as you guys probably already saw here in the drawing, isn't that what that's saying? It is saying there is some kind of force stopping me from pulling it forward. And that was your question at the beginning, is that will there be any resistance here of me pulling it? And yes, as you pull it, the more you pull it, the more current you make. The more current you make, the more force you create in terms of opposing to you. Right? And in fact, let's just go back to our mechanics again. If I was just going to pull this across at a constant speed, what would I know about these two forces? They're equal, right? So if I look at a scenario where I say, let's pull on that, that creates a current. Once that creates a current, that creates a force pulling back on me. And if I just match that, so I'm just going to tug it along, or maybe I should put it the other way. If I pull really hard or just a little bit, it's going to create either a lot of current or a little current, but it'll create enough current till those are balanced, if you will. And I'll just keep pulling it along at a constant force. So my net force will come out to be zero. That's a simple way of saying my applied force is equal to the magnetic force. But let's look in terms of energy here. This comes out to be pretty nice. How do you calculate the magnetic force? Wasn't this I L cross B? And maybe I should say magnitude. And so look at this. This is the I. As I look at the current here in the bar, the length of the bar would be L. Okay, so there's L. There's B. And in this case, it would be sine of too much going on? 90 degrees. And maybe this would be a good time to pause and look back. Because again, the process is not supposed to be that hard. What is hard? There's a lot of pieces here. I mean, if I were to give you two pieces to a jigsaw puzzle and tell you, look, those two fit together. Can you put them together? You could probably try just a few combinations and get them together. It's not so hard to put two pieces together that you know go together. But now let me give you a 10,000 piece puzzle. It's a bit harder, right? Because you got to keep track of every detail. So watch the details. I mean, here's what happened. I first of all started with a magnetic field, an external magnetic field. And in the process, I pulled the bar. In the process of pulling the bar, that induces a voltage. That voltage makes a current. The direction of that current opposes the flux that was already there from the outside bar. And then that current that is in the bar will have a force on it because of the force from the external field. And that's the part I'm talking about now, is that there is going to be a force pushing back. And so in this case, the current goes that way, the field goes down, and this then is the magnitude of the magnetic field, force, the force from the magnetic field. And that would have to be equal to the force that I am applying. And of course, if we extend that, we already said, now the current, though, has to do with how fast you're pulling it. So if I then put in my equation that I derived already for the current, I would get B squared, L squared, V over R is equal to the amount of force I applied. And that was your question early on. How much force do I have to apply? Well, your force you apply is connected to how fast you're going to pull it. And of course, it makes sense. It's also connected to how much resistance do you have. Because when you start pulling on it, how fast you pull it depends on how much current, how much voltage you get. How much voltage you get together with how much resistance you have determines how much current you get. How much current you get depends on how much force is pulling back on you. And so there's the interplay between the external field and then the induced voltage, which creates yet another field, and that current is going to have a force on it. I'll even take this one step further. Let's look at the energy here. Or maybe I should say power. But if I take my applied force and I multiply it by its velocity, and maybe I better go back to chapter 7. Work, or a little bit of work, is force times a little bit of distance. So if I divide that by a little bit of time, then power, work per time, is force times velocity. And so if I go, okay, this is how much power I am putting into it. I am applying a force times its velocity. That is the rate at which energy I'm applying into it. Where does that energy go? Yeah, it's not making the bar go any faster, right? Did you catch that? If there was not a magnetic force pulling back on it, wouldn't the force I'm applying just make the bar go faster and faster? And so if I was asking you, where does the energy go as I'm pulling on it, you would say it goes to kinetic energy. The bar goes faster and faster. But in this case, as I'm pulling on it, because of the opposing magnetic force, this bar doesn't go any faster. This bar keeps the same speed. So my question is, where does the energy go? Well, I guess it first makes electrical energy. The electrical energy makes current. The current runs through the resistor. The resistor makes heat. And so all of this mechanical energy I am putting in goes into electrical energy, which then goes into heat energy. I'll show you that in the next step. We just said the applied force is equal to this. That is a B squared L squared over R times a V. Then when I multiply it by the other V, I get a B squared L squared V squared over R. What was BLV again? The EMF. What's V squared over R? The power in the resistor, exactly. I'm not too surprised, and I hope you're not either. Maybe impressed with all the math we just did. That the force and the energy I put into it here is equal to the heat that shows up on the resistor. So I put some energy in, it goes into electric, the current flows, making heat in the resistor, and there is no gain or loss of energy. I can account for all the energy along there, right? Well, I'm glad that was only our first example before we get into any hard ones. Okay, and so there's the interplay. And we better do a lot more, obviously. Yeah.
So what if there's like not a resistor, or like maybe they're like superconductors or something? Can you not?
Oh, yeah, now there's a whole scenario that can take place. Let's try that. Let's say this resistor wasn't here. Let's say you just cut this. Okay. What would happen? Well, do you still get an EMF? Is there still an increase in flux? Yeah. It just now the circuit looks like this. what happens there? Do you have a voltage here? Yeah. But do you get any current?
I'm saying like it was just like a wire.
Oh, okay. Well, let's try both. Let's say there was no wire. Then I would say, hey, I am going to get an EMF. If I put a voltmeter here, the voltmeter would pick it up and say, yes, there is a voltage. But what I wouldn't get is I wouldn't get any current. And if I didn't get any current, then I am not going to get an opposing force. And there, with my hand pulling on it, it's going to be really quite simple. There is no magnetic force pulling back on it. Yes, I create a voltage, but so what? That's just a voltage. That's not any energy. I got to have current to keep the energy going. So when I pull on it without any opposition of a magnetic force, as I pull on it, it's going to have an acceleration and just go faster and faster. So all the work I do shows up as kinetic energy. And this would essentially be the same as no magnetic field, except for I would have a voltage that's created while I'm pulling it. But nothing real exciting about it. The energy doesn't go anywhere. Good example of this is just an airplane flying through the Earth's magnetic field. It's got two wings. It flies across. There's a voltage across the difference. So what? You don't lose any energy from the airplane. It just keeps flying. You want to put a voltmeter out there and measure its voltage. You know, have fun. It's not that great. It's not that big. People have tried to be creative with somehow kind of tapering off on that energy. But then you're just, you know, burning fuel to make electricity, which you can do that with a generator. So, you know, why mess with something that complicated? No, but your question, okay, was the other way around, right? The other way around is, what if the resistance is very small? All right, same thing though. If the resistance is very small and I would pull it, and as I pull on it, I would create a voltage. All right. That voltage then would create a current, a very large amount of current. That very large amount of current would mean that the magnetic force pulling back would be very, very large, even at really low speeds. And so I would reach equilibrium, even if I'm pulling really hard, I would reach equilibrium at a very slow speed. And so I'd be going like that, pulling as hard as I can, and the thing's barely moving with any speed because it's producing so much current. Well, if you're good with that one, let's mix it up a little bit. Let's change that one into this one. Instead of the airplane flying through the Earth's magnetic field, let's look at a helicopter's blade spinning in the Earth's magnetic field. Will there be a voltage from one end of the blade to another? Sure. Now, in this case, we are going to We are going to the case where I just won't put a circuit here. I'm not going to make a complete loop. Here is the metal beam. If you want to think of it as a resistor coming back like this, okay, fair enough. We can have a resistor trailing on back. But let's just talk about the voltage that it's producing. And then we won't have anything connected. Hence, we won't have a resistor, or we might say the resistor is infinite. Therefore, the rest of this we won't have a long discussion on. But I claim that if you take a metal bar and spin it as opposed to translating it, you will get a voltage. And so kind of copying that picture over here, I can look at this and ask this question: what is then the EMF between the rotational point here and the tip as it goes around? Is it going to do a voltage? Sure. Now, you might think this is a harder problem, and it is, because what would you say about each little piece of this metal rod? Okay, each is moving, so each little piece is producing a voltage, right? But aren't they at different speeds? All right, so sounds to me like a good calculus problem. Break it into little pieces, add up all the little pieces, total voltage is the sum of all those pieces. Yeah. So, fair enough. A conducting rod here. Well, I'll leave it at that, yeah. I mean, there's a lot to be added to that, too. But I'll just say, yeah, so conducting rod here. So I'm going to spin it along. But again, it's got length L. If you look at a little section out there, which your author does, and says, well, let's look at a very small section here. That little small section may create a very small EMF, DE. And of course, this is where you're hopefully getting real good at your calculus and saying, well, yeah, we don't know how to do it for something that has varying speeds, but we know how to do it for a constant speed. We just derived it. Let's take what we just did. Let's take the limit of that, then change it into an integral. We'll just add it all up. And so if I come over to here and apply this to here, I would say that this thing has a very small length of dr. And so it would be the strength of the magnetic field times the velocity times the length of that little piece. And if I make that piece small enough, smaller and smaller and smaller, as our calculus always argues, that then I can say every point on that little piece is going the same speed, right? I mean, if I give it any size, then I would say the inner piece and the outer piece have a different speed. But in the limit, as they get smaller and smaller and smaller, they truly do have the same speed. So I'm going to just put a V and a thickness of dr. So the total voltage is going to be the summation of the voltage as I add up this piece plus this piece plus this piece plus this piece plus this piece. And so it'd be like stacking batteries in series. I take a 1.5 volt, you know, like your calculators. How many go in there? 4 batteries? So, you know your calculator operates on 1.5 plus 1.5 plus 1.5 plus 1.5. So it's 6 volts that this thing is designed to operate. They just took the 4 batteries and added them up. And that's what I'm doing here. What is the total voltage? And so this is the integral of BVDR. And I will start here at 0 and go out to length L. And so, as it is spinning around, at least in the simplest case, I could say, okay, the magnetic field is the same over the entire metal bar. Maybe. Probably not really, but for the simple case, we'll just say the magnetic field is the same. But it's that next step. Is the velocity the same? No. So we've got to go back to our mechanics. What is the same for every little point on that bar? The angular speed, right? So why don't I replace its linear speed with its angular speed? And its angular speed would be omega times r. And as I integrate that from 0 to L, I would then have a b omega. That's the nice part about that. The omega is a constant over the whole bar. The r changes, so then I would get an r squared over 2 evaluated from 0 to L. And so the EMF would be that. The magnetic field times the angular speed times the length of the bar squared divided by 2. And so that's going to be the value of my EMF in a scenario like this. What is the value? Feeling a little better with it? Good. Got a lot less blank stares on that one. That's good. Shall we try another? How about something that looks like this? What if I have one coil embedded inside another coil? Probably not a surprise that I just happen to have one coil embedded inside another, right? So, why don't we start here? I'll start with this coil. I will hook it to a signal generator. For those of you who haven't seen this yet in lab, let me explain this piece of equipment here real quick. It simply is a fancy piece of equipment that can make current go back and forth in a sinusoidal pattern, what we're going to start referring to now as AC, alternating current, at whatever rate the dial is set at. I don't know if you guys can see from your distance, but can you see a 6.5? And over here it says kilohertz. So this thing is designed to make current go back and forth 6.5 thousand times a second. So if I were to put it like this, the current goes in and out, back and forth 6,000 times or 6,500 times. If I feed it to this coil, and so I will put one wire here and one wire here, this should be feeding current one way, then another, one way, then another. Why the AC? What if I hook this to DC? If I hook this to DC, wouldn't I just have a big magnetic field? But any change to it? No. So you can see why, using Faraday's law here, I am going to be hooking up to an AC source instead of a DC source. The DC would only have a change while I was turning it on and turning it off. Didn't you see that earlier back here when I took the coil and I turned it on, turned it off? You saw the change? But once it was fully on, was there any more induced current? No, there was no change. So this one is nice because I claim that if I take this, there is current constantly changing. And again, it's too bad I can't see it with my eyes here, but inside of that coil or outside of the coil, we'll do both, inside and outside of the coil. Looks like your author has a picture on the outside. I'll do inside first and then go to the outside. But if I could see that flux, I would see it getting bigger, smaller, negative direction, zero, bigger, zero, and it would just constantly be changing in here. And it would change 6,500 times a second. Fair enough? So, what if I take another coil and put it in here? Is there any voltage here? I claim there is. I claim there is an EMF produced in here. And of course, I brought the oscilloscope out so we can actually measure it. But before we measure it, let's calculate it here. Let's apply Faraday's law here and see if we can't calculate the electric field that is produced from the solenoid. Now, that's worth repeating. Did you catch that? Could you calculate the magnetic field from a solenoid? Could you calculate the electric field from the solenoid? All right, so I'm not talking about the magnetic field. Maybe I'll put that on the side. But if I have a solenoid and I asked you to calculate what is the magnetic field from my solenoid, that's what we did in the last chapter. That's not what I'm asking about. The magnetic field from a solenoid is this. And we're going to need that in just a second. However, that's not what I'm asking. And I want to make sure you caught that. I am asking you, can you calculate the electric field? Or for that matter, the EMF from the solenoid? So those are two different questions, right? One magnetic field, one electric. So don't mix that. But here's what I'll do. I'll start off with Faraday's law. Faraday's law says this. This is the value of the EMF. The EMF is equal to the rate of change of the magnetic field. Okay? The magnetic field in your loop. All right. So, let me look to see if your author has a picture on the inside. This is the outside. Well, I'll do outside first. Why not? All right, let's do outside first here. And so your author does this. Let's imagine us putting a wire. Or it doesn't even have to be a real wire here. If there is a wire, then that electric field is going to make current. But what I want you to see here is even without anything there, we're still going to get an electric field. We just won't get any current, which was kind of that question you had earlier. What if there's not a resistor there? Well, you're going to get a field. You just won't get any current. And so this blue path is what they say, let's this be our path. Let's calculate the voltage around that path. And if we put a wire there, then we can just take that voltage divided by the resistance of that wire, and that would tell us how much current is there. If we never put a wire there, we'll just get a field without any current. And so I will start with the right-hand side of the equation. So look closely at that blue little loop. I'm going to say, what is the voltage for one loop? Okay. Now later on, I will say, let's use more than one loop. Later on, I will use, so let me change it here. I'm going to put this as my solenoid so that this one can be on the outside. Okay. So here is my coil, and my question is, what's the field out here? And if I put a wire here, then what's the current? And we'll see if we can pick it up with the scope. But I'll start with just simply, here is my coil. And so when I go to calculate the field, I will say, let's just look at the magnitude. So I'm going to ignore the negative sign. And I will put 1. Wait a minute. 1? That looks like more than 1 there. Yeah, it does look like a lot more than 1, doesn't it? I wonder what it says. Oh, it says 180. Oh, so should I put 180? No. What's that N for? It's the induced EMF in the loop I'm trying to calculate. That blue one. How many loops are in that blue one? 1. Has nothing to do with this one. Don't mix it. It's so easy to do. We've got two things going on here. We got the field that is produced from the solenoid. And now the solenoid has a lot of turns, 180. But that's not what that N stands for out there. That N out in front stands for how many loops are you going to put. So I'm eventually going to put this in here. When I get there, I'll tell you how many. But just for the sake of conversation, let's think of it as just 1 for a moment. And that's what that blue one is showing. So that's why I put a 1. Don't use the 180. Is the 180 going to be relevant? You would think it would, right? And it is. Because isn't that where we get the field? So the 180 is going to show up, but it's going to be in here. It's not going to be there. Okay? And so keep track of what turns we're talking about. For terminology, we often call these loop primary and secondary. We say, okay, this solenoid here is the primary one. This is the one that makes the original flux. And then that flux is then put through a second coil, which is this one. And then there's an induced voltage here. So as we go forward here, I'll just use that terminology. This is the secondary. This is the primary. And so this N here is the secondary. How many turns are in my secondary? And again, in that picture up there, there's just one loop. All right, so now I'm going to take the derivative with respect to time. And I have to then say how much flux is going through that blue loop. And that's how I calculate magnetic flux. And maybe I'll start with the dot product. Cosine of what? B dot dA. Do you see it in here? Okay, so let's start with the first vector, B. What direction is B? Okay, it's in the solenoid. I can't really say left to right or right to left because it is an AC current. So at one moment it's going this way and the next moment it's going that way. But fair enough, it's either left to right or right to left depending on what moment in time. What direction is A? Well, A is the area of some loop. What loop am I trying to find? The blue one up there. So if I have this and I kind of take a cross section, make a blue loop here. Where's DA? Left, right, or right, left, right? It's like this. So isn't the magnetic field and the DA in the same direction? Or 180 degrees out of direction, depending on how you want to put it? I'll just do magnitude. So again, it's either a 0 degrees or it's 180 degrees in that picture. But did you notice how to get the angle? And to get the angle, I have to know where the magnetic field comes from a cylinder. Then we'd have to go back to last chapter, right? And so what is the field from a solenoid? And that's what I need to do in order to do this problem. I got to get the flux. All right, well, I'll keep going. Let's look at B now. Is B a constant?
Why did we use cosine of zero instead of sine of 90? Isn't the area perpendicular to the magnetic field?
Oh, yeah, but I used a dot product. That's the definition of a dot product. Cosine of the angle between them.
Okay.
So, and there's certainly other ways of writing how you calculate the angles between them, but when you write it as a dot product, that's what you mean by a dot product, a cosine of the angle between them. Okay, how about B? Is B a constant? Oh, so I can't pull it out of the integral? Oh, you guys are quiet today. I hope it's not just because of the end of the semester and you're probably operating on very little sleep. Good. It is a constant over the area. Isn't that what we learned about the magnetic field in a solenoid? But it is not a constant with time because we know that the magnetic field comes from the current. And I just set it up with the current changes with time. And so this is what I was talking about a few moments ago, where this is a good recipe for saying, let's pull B out of the integral. Because at any moment in time, we know that the magnetic field throughout the solenoid is a constant in space. But it changes with time. And there's two pieces of calculus up there. It's a constant in space, but not in time.
Could you say that the RMS value of B is constant? Can I pull it out?
No. I'm trying to avoid RMS for a couple chapters here, but RMS is a nice way of getting around things that aren't a constant, but if you don't handle it right, it gets you into trouble. And so it's, you know, the constant recipe I've been saying for the three semesters, or in your case, one semester you've had with me, is you got to be careful what the fundamentals are here and where what we mean by RMS and where it comes from. It can be useful in its time, but at other times it can't be. And in this case, if you were to pull it all the way out, you're going to see that everything else is a constant. You're going to have a derivative of a constant, which is zero, and you're going to say there is no EMF produced there, and that's very wrong. So we don't want to average our field or our current too early. Okay, so RMSs are great, but RMS is just a tricky way of saying, oh, it's equivalent to. All right, but again, as I don't know if I mentioned in this class, but it's like building a swimming pool on the second story of an apartment building. You know, you can do all the construction right. Does it matter how the first story's built? Yeah. You just don't think about the second story when you go to build the first story. The fundamentals behind it are absolutely crucial. And so you got to go back and look, what's the first story? What's the foundation? You know, what is all that built upon? And so that's where RMS comes in. You got to understand the foundation of those. So that's why we'll talk about RMS real soon. They're nice, but until we really understand what's going on, I don't think it's a good idea to even talk about RMS yet. So we don't. We haven't. Okay, but you saw my point. That I can pull it out of here, but I can't pull it in front of there. Okay? All right, I'll keep going. So I'll put the B there. When I do an integral of dA, I get, of course, A. But what area? I think it's safe to say you don't think it's the surface area of the Earth. No. But I see two coils there, right? I see the primary and the secondary. Secondary being the blue one. And the area of that blue one is pi little r squared. The area of the primary is pi r squared. Which one do I want? Well, let's see. I guess what I'm really saying is I want all the flux that goes through the big one, don't I? So does that mean I want little r? No. Because where is the flux? It's in the smaller one. How much flux is outside of the solenoid? Relatively zero, right. So when I go to think about how much flux do I want, or what r do I want, is I want the area where there is a field. I don't want anything bigger than my big one, because there's no way all the stuff outside of my secondary has anything to do with the flux inside my secondary. All right, so that alone limits it to my secondary. But even then, because of the way this one is set up, I want a smaller area than that, because I want only the part that has a magnetic field. And what we learned last chapter is a solenoid has a field on its inside and pretty close to zero on its outside, which, as you saw in the lab when you measured it, it wasn't exactly zero on the outside, but it tapered off pretty quickly. And so that's why I would have an r squared here. All right, let's keep going. Anything constant in here with time that I can pull out? Yeah, I think it's safe to say that the R is not changing, in at least the setup I have no way of mechanically changing the size of those wires. So that's not changing. If these were made out of elastic stuff, maybe that could be changing too, but that's not this case. But the B field is changing with time. That was our argument earlier on that said, hey, how do you get the B field? How do you get the magnetic field from the solenoid? So I could put in the derivative of mu naught and I there. And again, began to ask that same question. Mu naught is a constant. What's little n? Number of turns of which one? Yeah, that solenoid. We call it the primary here. That's the 180, right? This one here, that's where that 180 comes in to play. And so maybe I'll even put 180 divided by the length of it. And I think this, if I remember right, is 10 centimeters. Looks a little longer than that, but I'm just going to put 10 centimeters there to have something to work with. Actually, I'll just put in L. How's that? Do they give any symbols in there for the length of it? No. But I'll just do an L. And so then I have the derivative of the current. And that's the thing that's changing with time. And now that we've done all this math, you can clearly see that if I hook this up to a DC source, other than the point when I turn it on or turn it off, what would I say about a DC source? What would I say about the current there? Constant. What would you say about the derivative of a constant? Zero. So how much electric field would I get from a solenoid with a DC? Yeah, nothing, right? Zero. Other than the time when you turn it on and turn it off, which is what you saw earlier on. So the more interesting one is why I hooked it to an AC. This does change. And down here they say, this is the current. This is how I set up this function generator. The current changes with a cosine function here. So continuing on here, I would get pi r squared mu naught 180 divided by L time derivative of the maximum current, whatever that is, depends on, you know, the voltage setting, times cosine of omega t. So as I go to take the derivative, what's the derivative of a cosine? All right, negative sign. Okay, if I ignore the negative again, since I was just going to, I've always been ignoring negative. So I'm going to ignore the negative and put sine omega t. But there's something else I really want you to see. What else? the omega, right? The chain rule. All right, so finally, putting this chapter together with last chapters, I have found out that I have an EMF there. And I'll go one step further. Do you remember this little integral long time ago that the voltage, or for that matter, the EMF, is the integral of the electric field? And so, extending Faraday's law from just saying what is the EMF to what is the electric field, let's apply that to what is the electric field around this blue line. I can now start to do this side of the equation. This side of the equation would be the integral of the electric field around or along the direction that creates the EMF, which in this case is that blue loop. So as I go around that blue loop, I would have the electric field, and I would go around the loop, and it would be 2 pi little r big R. Little r, right? Because the EMF is the part in the blue loop. And so putting that all together over here gets me where I want to get. What is the electric field? I'll bring the 2 pi and r to the other side. I won't cancel anything quite yet, but here's the pi, here's the mu naught, here's the r squared, here's the 180, here is the maximum current, here is the angular frequency, here is the L, here is the 2 pi r, here is the sine omega t. Yay! And so, putting what looked like a simple equation here, remember, we started with just this, right? Integral over area, derivative with time, integral over length. There's 3 pieces of calculus in that. But once I put all 3 of those pieces of calculus together with stuff that I've already learned from previous chapters, I get a pretty long equation here. And so this is the electric field on the outside. And if you look closely at it, what is it saying? It is saying that the electric field depends on, and there's a number of factors here. One of those that at least I can change is, this is the number of turns in the solenoid. I can change that. I will in a second. This is the current in it. I will change that. This is the frequency in it. I will change that. This is the distance away, or how, I can't really change that one, but I can kind of fudge it. So we'll change that one too. But to see if this works, here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna switch this over to the oscilloscope and say, let's then look at the electric field on the outside. Now remember, we calculated it with one turn. So I'm going to take this, and just so we can pick it up a little more, hook it to where it whaps 440 times. But if I put these two together, like that, notice again, there's no metal connection between them. Fair enough? There is an electric field. There is an EMF in this bigger loop. And you're seeing it on the screen. What does it depend on? Well, maybe the easiest one for me to change is the frequency. If I were to change the frequency, isn't that a greater frequency? What does that equation say about greater frequencies? Stronger electric field. Did you see it get taller? Right? And so as I change, the frequency, I change the voltage. Now, hopefully that doesn't surprise you, because when we got started an hour ago, I wrote on the board Faraday's law, and it said the magnitude of the EMF is related to the rate of change. Remember that rate of change? And so you see it here in the equation. The higher the frequency, the higher this induces the EMF on the other side. So I do get a little EMF. I do get a little bit of current. You already saw this one time before. I'll try it again. But you might remember from yesterday, or that I did that. And I actually took a coil and a second coil. This one's kind of hard to tell it's a coil because we put it in a coil and we put it in wax so that we can show you next. But there, the energy is actually being induced in the other side. I get the energy transmitted from there to there. Some of you might even have chargers this way. I know my kids' toothbrushes are that way. They just kind of set it on the little stand. And it has a coil buried inside the handle of the toothbrush. And the little platform has a little coil. And so it sits there all day charging up, and then they can brush their teeth and put it back, and then it's charged. And some of you may have razors this way. Some of you might have those charging pads for your iPads or your iPhones, and you don't actually need to plug it in. Okay, we can just transmit it by inducing it in one side or the other. This one is dipped in wax, so you can bummer. Kind of make it a little waterproof, if you will. But the magnetic field is unaffected by the glass or the water, and so it just induces right through it and makes a little transmission. And of course, the higher that frequency, the better it is induced in the other side. So this doesn't transmit that much energy because it's at a low 60 hertz. That's why I've got this one set at, you know, I was at 6,000 and then I turned it up. I'm not sure what I am at now. Yeah. I didn't do anything extra other than just tighten it real tight. So it's probably not the best in the world.
What prevents the water from getting between the positive and negative?
When I clamp it down. Just me tight. The light bulb's bottom electrode is straight down. It's kind of like a V shape. When you tighten it down, you get a good tight fit for it. And then the side ones. And then the water fills up in there. And you know, you're thinking it might short circuit through the water instead of go through the filament. But this is really a relatively, you know, small effect.
So if water was able to get down there, then it would
short. Yeah, if I put like salt water in there, it would probably short circuit really well. This is just regular mineral water from Santa Barbara. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's different than what's happening.
No. No, no, no. You're talking about the fluorescent bulbs that
right.
People just hold in their hands when they're by the big power lines?
Short at the two ends of it, would it still light up?
Short it with what?
Wire.
With a wire, no, because it conducts so well. With water, probably still, because water's not that great of a conductor. I mean, I wouldn't want to hold power lines and stand in water. You know, so if this was a good conducting liquid, that's why I said if this was salt water, it probably would short circuit out. So, but anyways, I just wanted to run through these numbers. There is the number. What else could I change? Well, I guess I could change the current that's flowing in the primary, but that's hopefully so obvious that I don't need to adjust that too much. But I can do that here. And so sure enough, when I change the amount of current in here, I do change the amount that's induced on the other side. I could change the number of turns. I don't know if you noticed, but I said 180, but that's from here to here. There's only 90 from there to there. And so I've got different plugs. And so there is only 90, there is 180. And so I get a different amount. And probably some losses because it didn't look like it was a 2-to-1. In fact, I'm not even sure that's 90. Maybe that's more than 90. And it looks like it's about 2/3 of it. So it's more than 90. And distance would matter. I can't really take this and make it bigger in circumference, but what I can do is pull it out a little bit, and it essentially is getting farther and closer and further and closer, and so I can have some effect. How about the other way around? What if I was looking for the electric field inside of the solenoid? So I reverse roles here. Let me take this as my primary. And this is now my secondary. And so what is the field on the inside? Well, you can see that there is a field. What would change up here? Well, let's start back here at the beginning. I'm going to get the magnitude of the EMF. Okay. And let's talk about just one loop for the beginning. So I'll take a blue loop on the inside, if you will. So I'll still call that a 1. Okay. I would still have the change in magnetic flux. I would need to take the dot product, but wouldn't the dot product still be the same? Yeah.
So when you change the number of loops on that thing, the rest of the loops are just not connected? Like half, the top half is not connected?
Right.
So the voltage should stay the same, because while you decrease the number of loops, you also decrease the magnetic field, right?
Oh, the length of it.
Right.
Yes, I did.
So the voltage should be exactly the same when you
Yes, I did. So maybe that's good point. I didn't catch that. Yeah. Would anything else change? Make sure we're not missing anything else. But yeah.
The way a transformer works is you have
this is yeah.
Density to the right, but the lengths are the same, right? And that's what changes the voltage.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. I was just looking at that one, but that would have changed too, and they would have changed in the same proportion. Yeah. Good. Good. Yeah, good observation. All right. Now back to this. Anything different? Here? No. Here? No. Here? Yeah. Now what's different now? You see the flux through the loop. And the loop is now on the inside. So I don't want all the flux that's inside this big cylinder. I only want the flux that's going to go through my blue loop. My blue loop now being on the inside. And so now that is in R squared. So I think that's the only thing that changes throughout here. Because then I'm still going to feed it in, although I guess since I reversed roles, that won't be 180 anymore. That's going to be 400. The L is about the same, so I won't mess with that one. The current, that probably changed a little bit because I have different wires and a different length of my wires and a different resistance. But let's just say that one didn't change. Because what I really wanted to get at was just to show you that when this is all said and done, I still have an electric field, but what is different is that this field is linear in R, as opposed to decreasing with R. It still depends on the current and the angular frequency. And still is sinusoidal on the other side. So you send in a current. The voltage you produced is out of phase, if you will, but still sinusoidal, cosinusoidal, if you prefer to label one versus the other. But again, you can see that higher frequencies and lower frequencies change the voltage on it. What I can't show you is, though, that the electric field has a different strength. In fact, right in the very center of the solenoid, according to that, right at the very center, R would be zero. So there would be no electric field right at the center. Now, there'd still be a magnetic field, right? It's not mixed that, okay? But there would be no electric field. So the electric field would get bigger and bigger and bigger until you get to the primary coil. Then as you leave it, it gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And so I'm inducing a voltage in a second coil.
So did you change the part of the loop, the blue loop that was up there?
Yeah, so I don't have a good picture of it, but if I go back to this picture, the blue loop, I'm now thinking of a blue loop that is inside, which is why the little r now is going to be smaller than the big R, which is why when I calculate the flux through the blue loop, I need the little r. Even though there's more flux outside of the blue loop, this equation is saying how much flux goes through the blue loop, and I only go out to r. Whereas last time, the blue loop was bigger than capital R. Oh, yeah, now the other side of the equation, good point. I didn't mention this side of the equation. But this side of the equation is the EMF around the blue loop. So as I try to calculate the electric field around the blue loop, it would be the distance around the blue loop. And so that would still be a 2 pi r. So that r remains the same. That one doesn't change. And so the r on the two sides of the equation become the same, and that's why they cancel, whereas before on the outside they didn't cancel. Well, again, going back to, whoops, I left that on. It's getting pretty warm. You saw this before on Tuesday, but it's worth seeing it again just to kind of remind you. Oh, question.
Why is the pattern so much more uniform with coils than
that? That's more of a quality, I think. I don't think I'm picking up other stuff, but this coil here, and you're going to see it in the lab, it's kind of unfortunate, but because we've hooked a lot of times up here and the solderings aren't that good and they're exposed, you just don't get a nice uniform current as we do with this. This is just a better quality, no real loose connections, well tight, the windings are nice and smooth, there's no tapping in the middle, and we always get good fields with this one, and we've never gotten a good pickup or good fields with that one. In fact, I brought out some Faraday's laws, I guess I was going to show you, but maybe since you brought it back to my attention here, is I thought I'd bring this out. Maybe you recognize this, maybe you don't. Anybody recognize this? This is a hard drive. How does it work? Well, here's why it's called a hard drive. It's got magnetic material. Hard. Magnetic material. And then, you guys even remember the days of floppy drives? Okay, so then it had a floppy magnetic material, a soft magnetic material. But the hard magnetic material means that you can do things with a little more accuracy. There's not flexibility. So the memory storage, the density storage is much greater on a hard drive than on a floppy drive here. And the flash drives have kind of replaced all those old floppy drives here. But this spins. This little tiny coil, which I'll pass around, you can barely see it in there, is really one of these. And the whole idea is if I put this near a magnet and the magnet moved by it, so maybe I'll put that down and imagine a little tiny magnet near a coil and it moves by, bink, what's going to happen? As this field goes by, doesn't it induce a current? That is where the memory is. And so the shape and the pattern of all these billions and billions of little magnets that are sitting on your hard drive And the reason they have to be spinning is Faraday's law, because you have to have a moving magnet. As it spins by, it's going to induce current. And so whatever, say, picture you have saved on your hard drive, there's millions and millions of little magnets up, up, down, down, up, 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 down, down. And when they swing by, pulse, 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 is the pattern that encodes the information that is on that hard drive. And so that's why today's world is heavily reliant on magnetism here, because we can store it on here and then use Faraday's law. And that's why we got to have these crazy things spinning, and that's why they die after a particular time, and you always want to have your backups going there, because this thing's just spinning. And that's why when you put it to sleep, it stops spinning it. And so when you walk up to your computer, you know, going to sleep, save some electricity, because the hard drive's not spinning, but then use the hard drive, it's got to be spinning. So you have to walk up and kind of shake the mouse and get it spinning again. And so there is your traditional application of using Faraday's law. This goes a little bit older, so you may not recognize this one. I don't know. You're not that old, are you? Do you or that young. Do you recognize this one? Right? The VHS, right? I should probably bring an audio cassette. You probably haven't seen an audio cassette, no? But whether it be a video, and so this is one I just kind of took apart so I can illustrate it here, but the whole movie is recorded on here. Billions and billions of little tiny magnets. And they have to move. They have to go by. They have to use Faraday's law. And so all of our information is stored on something magnetic. This happens to be magnetic tape. This one happens to design, and if you were looking at it, you would have injected the tape up at top. The tape goes forward, plops down, and as you look at the tape comes out and rides around this reed head. There's the spinning head. And that thing will spin around and read a frame. And then the tape moves for the next frame and the next frame. And it reads one frame every 30th of a second. And so this tape would have the information for one frame kind of labeled across the diagonal like that, and then the next one like that, and the next one like that, and the next, and so the tape just plays for an hour, getting each frame, however many frames you need in an hour, and 3,600 seconds times 30 in a second. Yeah.
If they can get more EMF by increasing the frequency, why do we only have our walls running at 60 hertz? Why not something much higher?
Oh, but we're not trying to induce that into somewhere else. Right? You don't take the power from the wall by this method I was showing. You actually plug in a plug. Is that what you're saying? Okay, so the point is, getting power out of 60 hertz by induction is going to be very difficult. Very, very difficult. And when the first radios were built, they realized that hey, this would work to transmit information from a transmitter to a receiver, except at low frequencies, you're not going to get much. So the biggest challenge in the first wireless communication was building something that would generate a very, very high frequencies. And so they did it mechanically, spinning things, you know, 50,000 hertz, you know, amazing. But small compared to radio stations of today. But they knew that they could not generate radio waves at the same frequency as sound waves, because there just wouldn't be much energy radiated out. So that's why the radio waves are way up there. Well, I'll pass this around if you guys care to look at it. But it, nonetheless, I think is a good example here of Faraday's law. And what I started to show you before I got sidetracked back over there was, this is what we saw before. This is the ring. This is what you might call your primary. This is what you might call your secondary. Okay? And so when I put this ring on here, if you remember, I had two of them. Remember the one that was cut? If I put the one that is cut on here and turn it on, and the one that is uncut and put it on, I get a different effect. They both have Faraday's law. They both have an electric field around them. How come this one doesn't levitate, but this one does? Right, I heard somebody say it. According to Faraday's law, they're both going to get an EMF. But the one that's cut is like it has a lot of resistance, and therefore the current is very small. But this one, which is a nice thick wire, or aluminum, but it has very low resistance. And so even though the EMF may be a fraction of a volt, the resistance is probably less than a thousandth of an ohm. And so there's probably hundreds of amps going around here. And if there's hundreds of amps going around here, what else happens? This becomes an electromagnet. And what happens with the magnetic field and that magnetic field? They repel. So Faraday's law is still the same for both of them. The difference is the resistance in the loop, which results in a different current, and the different current results in the two different magnetic effects between the two. In fact, let's draw a picture of it. Now that we have Faraday's law, maybe now we can see how direction comes into play here. Let me draw that very large coil that's on the desk here. And for the sake of discussion here, let's say at one moment in time, the current is going in a direction this way, such that this would be the North Pole and this would be the South Pole of it. And again, let's just say the current is increasing. So if I were to take a second loop, and that's what this one is, floating up here, a second loop. So there's my secondary loop right there. As the flux is going through that loop and increasing and increasing, which way is the current in that blue loop? Okay, so the flux was going that way and now more is going that way. That means this wants to oppose it, so I'll put my thumb down. And my fingers will then be wrapping in this direction, okay? So this would be the direction of the current. Now, if the current is going in that direction, this too would be a little magnet. And the magnetic flux would be this way, right? And this would be a North Pole. And did you notice the two North Poles are together? What happens to two North Poles? They repel. And we could change the scenario. Let's say it's a little different. Let's say it is a South Pole and the current is increasing. So if I have this and the current happens to be at a moment like this, where this is now a South Pole, and I take my blue loop, I would say, okay, let's see. The loop is near the South Pole, so I already have flux going down into the loop. But if the current happens to be at a point where it's increasing, then the flux would be growing in that way. The current in here, according to Faraday's law, or Lenz's law, I should say, opposes that. So I would want to make flux upward, which would then curl my fingers in the direction for the current to go in that way. So the current would be opposite of that one. But when the current is going in that direction, that would make flux coming out here and in here. Again, notice two south poles near each other. What do we know about two south poles? They repel also. And so this little ring levitates for just that reason. Is it induces a current. And what's new, I want to make sure I emphasize this, because this is what makes the chapter easy or hard for people. The new part is the induced current. The rest of it we already did. Although, you may not be feeling comfortable with everything you've already done, and so we've got to look at what is the field from here, what is the induced field from there. And so this levitates. Let me show you this one. This is one of my personal favorites, actually. Here's a pipe.
AC going through that.
AC going through which one?
It is. So isn't the field going back and forth?
Yeah, so that's why I said at one moment I would have this, another moment I would have this, another moment, you know, and it would constantly be changing. But I wanted to show you that as it changes, the current in the loop above changes, and so we got repulsion here, we got repulsion there. And so the current, the induced current, does change also. If you didn't have AC, this would be pretty boring. This would just be a constant field. There'd be no change in flux. No change in flux would induce any current. No current here, and the little coil would just sit there right on top.
Does the current change like
crystally? No, it changes sinusoidally. It's plugged into the wall, so the current goes up and down and up and down. Look at this little pipe here. It is a copper pipe. I can drop a metal piece through here. Probably won't surprise you that it goes through kind of quickly. It's not a very long pipe, so it should go fast. But I can drop another little metal piece. And it takes a lot longer to fall. Why the difference? This one's a magnet? Really? It is a magnet. You're not going to see it on copper because copper is non-magnetic. And so when you drop, In fact, here's a nice way of seeing it also. If you drop it outside of the pipe, they fall together. But in the pipe, it's a very slow drop. But again, it's the same basic idea that you just watched with that floating ring. As this thing goes down, if you look at around this pipe right here, and I put, say, the north side down, I would say down here there is no flux. And as this thing falls towards it, it makes a flux through that ring. That's going to make a current. The current is going to go around this loop. As it goes around the pipe, it will make itself a magnet. And so we've got current going in this pipe. That's why it's made out of copper, because it's non-magnetic but conducts really well. And so as it drops through, take a look at it. It's kind of fun to watch. It's not rubbing. There's not friction as it goes down. It is just hovering right in the center, going right through the end of it. And it's inducing a current as it goes along. Look at this picture. Your author does a pretty good job here of looking at what we like to call an electromagnetic break. What if you had something that can swing or move, or using today's technology, something that can move would be a good example of a car tire. This is a pendulum, not quite a car tire, but if you can imagine applying this to a car tire, it goes back and forth. Now I want you to see that, because I want you to see that these are really good bearings. I mean, this thing rocks back and forth pretty well. I mean, obviously it's going to stop eventually, but it's got very low friction. Let me change it slightly. What if I take this very strong magnet and I make it rock through the magnet? Anything different? Without magnet? With magnet. Why does it break? Move magnet. Why does it move? Well, again, maybe this picture helps here, but this metal piece, which in my case is made out of aluminum here, comes swinging down. I have a magnet, North Pole, South Pole. But as that piece of metal gets in there, isn't there then going to be some magnetic flux going through there? There wasn't before, now there is. And so in this case, the magnetic flux comes from here, north to south, and as this comes in, you're going to get some flux that way. The current will set up to oppose that change. So you will get a little bit of a ring right here. You are going to get Faraday's law. But let's take that one step further. If this is making some current, wouldn't this then be a little North Pole on this side? And look at this North Pole coming near that North Pole. What do those two North Poles do? They oppose. And then on the other side of this, this would be a South Pole, opposing a South Pole. So as this little piece of metal tries to go in, it's making eddy currents here that make a South Pole opposing that South Pole. And this side makes a North Pole, which opposes that North Pole. And good luck trying to get it in. It's hard to get it in. Look at it coming out. When it comes out, by that time you already have flux inside of your metal. So the flux tries to come out. As the flux stops going through it, it was going that way, you're going to have to create current in the purple to go that way. And when you create purple in this way, then this side is going to be a South Pole. What happens between a South Pole and a North Pole? They attract each other. So as it tries to swing out the other side, it is being pulled back inside. So on this side, it is being opposed to going in. On this side, it's being opposed going out. And hence, we have an electromagnetic break. It's the whole reason why we have the second one. What's the difference between these two? Hopefully I will convince you that it is, well, it is still on a set of good bearings. And so it's swinging back and forth, very little friction. What happens when I put this one in here? Notice the cuts. What are the cuts going to do? You can't run the current in the little loops. You lose this ability to go in a circle. It's like this ring again. I mean, yeah, it's inducing a voltage, but without a closed circuit, you don't have any current. Without any current, you don't have the second magnetic field. Without the second magnetic field, you don't have the interaction, and so this one swings along. There is a little bit because it can make small amounts of currents, no bigger than the, you know, the half a centimeter that we cut it there. But there's our, you know, our effect. Look at this one. This is one of my favorite ones. If I take this crazy power supply again and lower it down to, not too low, I want to get a good field. Turn it on. What if I were just to put a metal plate here? Remember this? Remember the light going on? Why did the light go on? Well, the flux from here induced it in this current, which made the light go on, right? Now, it didn't make too much current because there's actually quite a bit of resistance between the filament in this and these long wires. So if I just take a copper plate that's about an eighth of an inch thick and I put it here, it's going to make current in little eddy circles here. And when it makes a current, just like back here, if it's going to make the current, and there's very low resistance here. So these little currents that are in a circle are probably hundreds, if not thousands of amps. And if they make a current, they're going to be a field. And so just like we mentioned here, they oppose each other. That's what's happening to here. It opposes, lifts it up. Then the current goes to zero, and so it falls back down. Then it opposes and goes back up. And so what I have is something that looks like, how are we doing on time? Oh, all right. I have a field, and I'm going to put a copper plate here. And so what I want you to see is if this is a north pole, then the current would be set up. So below is a north pole, and on top is a south pole. And so it repels each other, really no different than this. But that's not the big thing I really want you to see. All this does is make a bunch of noise. And it opposes it, and it falls, and it opposes and falls. And maybe you even hear that with high power electronics. You can hear a vibration to it. It is inducing current. And you'll hear that, what we call that 60 cycle hum. And that's what this is. However, here's where the fun begins. What if, in addition to this plate, I put a second plate on top of it? That too will induce some current. That too will make a north pole and a south pole. So whereas these two opposed each other, what happens to these two? They attract each other. Better still, here's my second plate. When I put them on top of each other, they will attract. What if I put them on a top offset? Where this one can turn. Then this one makes an induced magnet. This one too makes an induced magnet. But the north pole from this one and the north pole from that one are offset. So doesn't this one pull on this one at an angle like this, causing it to spin? And I have a Faraday induction motor. I can create a very simple motor by taking one plate, this thing out of the way, one plate, and putting a second plate over the top. Very little moving parts other than the wheel itself. Can you see it spin? Convince you. It started on its own. Wasn't me. And so the induced fields, these invisible fields, spin. And so this is another nice design of electric motors, using the inductions instead of using the forces and currents and commutators and blah, 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 blah. So, spin. All right, well, bummer. Hope to show you a few other things, but well, I guess I will on Tuesday. Give it to me whenever you can.